What's happening, guys? Keith here with another edition of the Impact Report. So I think we are going to move the Impact Report to an all-audio show, just kind of my preference with it. I will still be doing my podcast review of the Impact television show in video form, but for the Impact Report, I think it's going to be audio only. I'm trying to move in the direction of getting this podcast onto a bunch of platforms. Right now, we are available on YouTube, Podomatic, Podbean, SoundCloud, and we are also available on iTunes. So if you guys could head over to iTunes, I think you just search the Clock Cleaners. It'll come up. And if you give me a review, that would be fantastic. But let's get on to business. So let's talk about some good stuff. This past week's Impact drew 399,000 viewers, its second highest ratings on Pop TV. It ranked 104 on cable's top 150. This is fantastic news. I talked last week about, or after last week's 362,000 viewers, and hoping the trend continued upwards and being able to hit that 400,000 mark, and then this past week, bam, we're there. I mean, the highest rated episode was only at 410,000, and that was the episode of the final deletion, so this is just great news all around. But I mean, the ratings definitely reflected the quality of the show. We had the debut of Sue Young, and she's got a decent-sized following, and I know people were interested in seeing her debut, as I had saw on Twitter. There was a lot of buzz around that. We had Brian Cage versus Bobby Lashley in a huge match, and Matt Sydal facing Austin Aries in a title versus title match in the main event. So, I mean, the show definitely had drawing power. And, I mean, next week we have Moose versus Eli Drake with the briefcase versus briefcase. And Taiji Ishimori versus Johnny Impact. Bobby Lashley calls out Brian Cage. So I would assume we're going to get another rematch there at some point in the future. So we really should have another good show on our hands. But obviously, with the positives, there are some negatives. I mean, it's mostly just the same complaints we've had week in and week out. The first being the Global Wrestling Network flashback, you know, taking too much time on the show and not leaving the logo on the screen. You know, I mean, if you're a casual viewer and you look at the show and you're like, who the hell are these guys? Just keep it on the screen while it's shown. That's really it. We're not asking that much. Second being the matches from other promotions. I mean, I just feel like these should either be a Global Wrestling Network exclusive or even a YouTube exclusive. Hell, you could even put them on the Explosion show that, you know, it airs in other parts of the world and it's exclusive to the Global Wrestling Network here in America. But I don't know if there's a reason why these are putting on the television broadcast, but I feel like it just disrupts the flow of the show and it isn't consistent with the quality of the show. But last is the crowd in Orlando. I mean, I get it. It definitely does take away from the matches as you're preoccupied with people just standing around and looking bored, playing on their phones. But, you know, I don't think the time to leave Orlando is just yet. It'll be interesting to see how the shows are during the next set of tapings as things have been moving in the right direction. Obviously, the viewership increased, the more buzz around the product. So maybe we'll see the Impact Zone packed out more. I mean, we all know it is possible, as in the past, it used to be packed out like crazy. So there's still a chance that, you know, this could happen. Obviously, they're in the rebuilding phase, so these things are expected. But I understand that, you know, using Orlando to tape TV is easier for them and taping a huge chunk of episodes at a time. But, you know, let's look at the positives here. While they've been doing that, you know, the tapings are out of the way for 12 weeks or whatever the period is. But this has really given the time for the company to build other platforms. I mean, the Global Wrestling Network is updated all the time with all their partnerships, one night onlys, Twitch specials. I mean, WrestleCon coming up, we have Lucha Underground versus Impact Wrestling. I believe this is the first time Impact Wrestling is actually going to be on the WrestleCon weekend. So, I mean, that's a huge step in the right direction. And while we, you know, have some negatives to talk about, it's not like it's the end of the world. It's not really the quality of the product, but things that definitely will get changed in the future. But speaking of WrestleCon, I mean, Impact Wrestling is going to have such a busy week ahead of them. They'll be doing all streaming throughout the weekend, starting Thursday. It's all going to be on their Twitch page. They're going to start streaming Thursday night at 8 p.m. to 10 p.m. They're going to have some sort of live cast with Josh Matthews and Sanjay. It's interesting that they put this up against the Impact television show. I mean, granted, it's not like it's going to be huge news, as I believe it's just a rundown of what's going to happen throughout the week and then guests coming in and out. But just odd that they would put it head-to-head with their own television show. Just one of the things that I was confused about. Maybe someone can shed some light on why they're doing this or... Yeah. But it'll run all the way through Sunday at 12 noon. There's apparently over 30 hours of content throughout the weekend. A lot of workouts, dinners, just kind of getting a personal look at the Impact talents' lives. I mean, it's really a cool concept. ImpactWrestling.com has the entire schedule laid out, and it's definitely cool to get the behind-the-scenes look. I'm looking forward to it. I mean, I have to work Friday all day, so I'm not going to be able to catch a lot of the stuff, but the fact that it's going to be going on for so long and live is definitely a step in the right direction, as, you know, most of Impact stuff is pre-recorded. Other good news is that the last update I saw, there were only two available seats left for the reserve seating of Lucha Underground versus Impact Wrestling. I believe they will be updating the rest of the card throughout the week. So, great news there. I'm really looking forward to the show and the weekend as a whole. There's so much good wrestling going on. I mean, let's hope there's some more Impact and Lucha Underground working together in the future. So, speaking of which, I spoke a while back about Impact Wrestling reportedly being interested in Jeff Cobb. So apparently this past week, according to everyone's favorite wrestling observer, Dave Meltzer, the Impact Wrestling has offered Jeff Cobb a two-year contract, but he has yet to sign. Jeff Cobb had posted a photo last week in front of the New Japan Pro Wrestling Dojo with the caption, "Let the rumors begin." So we don't know the validity of this. Like I said, we knew there was interest on Impact Wrestling's end, but... once we have more information, I will let you guys know about that. Still, it would definitely be a great signing if Impact was able to secure Jeff Cobb. Not sure. I know he just taped season 4 of Lucha Underground, so I'm not sure what's going to happen after that. So a few weeks back, I spoke about the Impact Wrestling and Rise partnership. This past week, Impact Wrestling posted an official press release on their website about the partnership. Most of the same things that I had gone over when I spoke about it, but we did find out that Sienna will serve as a color commentator for the Rise Ascent taping. I think this is definitely a spot where the wrestling world could definitely do something different. I think Impact should look into using a female as a commentator for their Impact television show. I feel like it's... it would be a step in the right direction. One of the things I don't know why WWE hasn't done with their so-called Women's Revolution, you would think they would go that way, but I think Impact should definitely take the first step and do it, even if it was just on the Explosion show, just to, you know, be different and out there. But anyway, just my personal thought on that. But it was noted that past events from Rise can now be seen on the Global Wrestling Network, including all 2016 and 2017 shows. Impact Wrestling will work with Rise to develop other original content for the platform, as well as its Twitch channel. So this is great news. Like I said, women's wrestling has become a huge thing, and maybe we'll get to see a Knockouts Knockdown One Night Only partnered with Rise in the future. Yeah, good things. But last but not least, Sanjay Dutt was on this past week's Impact Media Call. I'll just go over some topics that he talked about. I mean, you guys can check out the media call if you want to listen to it. You can head over to WrestlingWithWrestling.com and click on the Impact Wrestling tab and scroll down. I think it's like the second or third thing in that tab. But yeah, he spoke about, you know, being unsure about his plans once he recovers from his injury, as he misses being in the ring. But he has a lot on his plate being a producer and color commentator. He hopes that Lucha Underground and Impact Wrestling relationship continues to bloom. He says that Impact is still in its rebuilding stages as they want to bring stability to the product in the ring and on television. Everyone is working hard to keep things in the right direction, as wearing many hats comes with the territory. You know, everybody's kind of got a lot on their plate at this point, you know, with losing Jeremy Borash. I mean, that's one more person that was doing a lot, and now it's spread to other people. He talks about being a commentator and working with Josh Matthews. He praises the Knockout division and how it's growing. He talked about Kira Hogan and Sue Young. He says he'll be scouting New Orleans for talent, as he still has his ears to the streets, as he put it. He talked about, I think, Rev Pro Show and Joey Janela's Spring Break, that he hopes to attend some other shows during the weekend, as there was going to be so much going on in Impact Wrestling's own world that it might be tough for him to go elsewhere and check out other things. But there's other people around to check things out. He gave praise to Sami Callihan and Matt Sydal's creativity. He said that Sami stands out as a creative force. He gave praise to Brian Cage for his athleticism. And what we've seen is just the tip of the iceberg. I mean, this media call happened before Thursday's Impact. So, I mean, he hyped his match with Lashley. He talked about plans in place to do future tapings outside of Orlando. He praised the current relationship with other promotions and that the door isn't closed to more relationships. He said he had the same mindset as Scott D'Amore about bringing in Jimmy Jacobs as part of the production team. He said he's very tuned in, dialed in, and his influence is already being felt on the product. Yeah, I think he covered a few more things like EC3's departure, you know, Eddie Edwards' bad incident, and a couple other things. So, like I said, if you guys want to check out the media call yourselves, it's on wrestlingwithwrestling.com and through the Impact Wrestling tab. That's pretty much all I have for you guys this week. Looking forward to this upcoming week with Thursday's Impact, and then Friday through Sunday, all the Impact Wrestling, WrestleCon stuff that's going to be streamed on Twitch. So hopefully this will bring in a bunch of new viewers. And, you know, this is just great news for Impact Wrestling. So thanks for taking time out of your day to give this a listen. And as always, I will see you guys Thursday for my Impact Wrestling review. And until then, don't forget to like, share, and subscribe. Thanks, guys.